Inshallah, we'll begin with our first speaker, Ustada Zaynab. Zaynab Ansari Abdul Razak is a native northerner with northern roots. She spent several years studying the core Islamic sciences, including Arabic, jurisprudence, Quranic recitation and commentary, hadith and prophetic biography in Damascus, Syria, at Abu Nur Masjid's college preparatory program. Upon her return to the United States, she continued her Islamic studies privately with Sheikh Khalil Abdul Rashid, Imam of New York's Iqra Masjid, Sheikh Faraz Rabbani, Educational Director of Seeker's Guidance, Sheikh Jamaluddin Haisa, and Dr. Fariha Khan, Assistant Professor of Religion and Anthropology at Willamette University. From 2004 to 2009, she volunteered, answered questions, and taught for Sunni Path Academy. She currently answers questions for Seeker's Guidance Answers blog, writes for Aziza Magazine's Dean Department, and volunteers with the Islamic Speakers Bureau of Atlanta. She did her undergraduate work in history and Middle Eastern studies and is planning to pursue a master's degree in world history at Georgia State University in the fall. She is married and has three children. Without further ado, I invite Ustada Zaynab to the stage.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على سيد المرسلين محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم لك الحمد حق حمدك كما ينبغي لجلال وجهك ولعظيم سلطانك سبحانك لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد السلام عليكم I want to first of all start off by thanking Brother Ahmed Salim and Al-Farooq Masjid for organizing this event. Hopefully the audio is okay. Are you able to hear me? All right. So, you know, thank you very much, Brother Ahmed and the Masjid. I mean, I think it's really, as I was saying to my husband, you know, when other people are kind of getting their crunk on Saturday night, you know, alhamdulillah, we're at the Masjid. So there is a lot of blessing in this gathering. So just to keep it real, honestly, subhanAllah, this is, I think we need to, and I'm going to be touching on this, but we really need to all thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the gift of Iman, because it's a gift that these days seems to be kind of, in some sense, shrinking as we look around us. So, and also just wanted to acknowledge the fact that my mom, sister Kafi Ansari, and my dad, Brother Mansour Ansari, are in the audience, and, you know, without them having encouraged me and my sister to study many years ago in Damascus, you know, I probably would not be able to share these few things with you that I learned from my teachers. So just to clarify something, Brother Ahmed, I'm actually not looking to pursue a master's degree. I'm in my last semester of coursework, so dua is requested that I actually finish everything. And quite importantly, I'm really honored to be kind of sitting on this panel with my husband and talking about this really kind of relevant, apt topic of love in Islam. So, alhamdulillah, I think this is a pretty awesome gathering. So I'm really not going to speak long, and please forgive me, I will be using notes, you know, as a mom. I'm not as quick on the uptake as I used to be, so I kind of need notes when I do this kind of thing. But there are really just two points that I want to make tonight in reference to our topic, love in Islam, is that, first of all, we really kind of have to look at this from the perspective of faith. I mean, you know, the whole idea behind this panel is Valentine's Day was day before yesterday. So this idea of romantic love is just sort of like, you know, a wash in the air. It's what people think about. It's what's being pushed by the popular culture. You know, and in many ways, you know, since we are kind of products of our environment, especially for those of us who haven't gotten married, you know, we're sort of looking at love through the lenses of the media and the press and popular culture. So in many ways, our views of romance and relationships are really kind of fashioned by, you know, those impressions. And my husband will talk more about the impact of media. But what I'm really arguing for is that we have to kind of stand back and assess what we know about love from the perspective of faith. And how, when love is discussed in the context of our religious teachings, in the context of the Quran, in the context of the Sunnah, very rarely is the conversation of love sort of decoupled or detached from a discussion of responsibility, a discussion of piety, and a discussion of obedience. So when we talk about love, it cannot be detached and divorced from the responsibility sort of underpinning that love. So a good example might be perhaps the ayah. This is ayah 31 in Surah Ali Imran, which occurred to me. أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِ يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ. Right? وَاللَّهُ غَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ. So this is basically Allah Ta'ala, God Most High, revealing to the Prophet, tell the people that if you really do love Allah, then do what? I.e., if you love Allah, you know, there is some kind of condition predicated on that love of Allah. You have to follow it up with something, some level of responsibility, which is فَاتَّبِعُونِي, obey the messenger, follow the prophet's pattern and his sunnah and his tradition, and then what will come after that? In turn, Allah will love you and forgive you your sins because Allah Ta'ala is forgiving and most merciful. So we have this Quranic discussion of love, and it's centered all around love of God, that sort of predicated on loving the person that God sent to, you know, humanity with this divine message. And by following that sunnah, by bringing honestly one's inclinations, one's hawa in accordance with the sunnah, then the love of God and the forgiveness of God descend. I mean, that's a really beautiful concept. And I think the reason why that kind of appeals to me is that if we kind of think about love and relationships in terms of responsibility, that really kind of elevates the discussion, right? It takes it away from the narcissism that we see in the society, where love is all about, okay, what am I going to get on Valentine's Day? And what am I going to get on my birthday? And when I get married, you know, what kind of mahr can I collect? And, you know, these sorts of things. It kind of takes away from me, and it's all about me, to what can I do for that other person so that I might become beloved of that person? And most importantly, how can I become sort of beloved of Allah through that person, right? As one of my teachers explained to me in Damascus, and we make dua for the victory of the Muslims in Syria, is that, you know, you always, in essence, you always have sort of a triangle, right? You know, this idea of this kind of really sort of esoteric way of approaching the divine and loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, kind of outside of your relationships, just doesn't really make sense, especially for women. She said that we have all these opportunities, and this is a sheikha, that you have all these opportunities to get to the love of Allah around you, but just look at the people who are positioned in your life, right? So how are you with, you know, your spouse, and how are you with your children, and how are you with your parents, for example? I mean, it all goes through that level of responsibility, you know, towards that person. So I just wanted to make that point. It's point number one. Do not decouple the conversation. And this is really directed towards people who are just starting out on this path of relationships. Don't decouple the conversation from one about responsibility and one about sort of giving as opposed to taking, right? It needs to be more about sort of mutual fulfilling of one another's rights as opposed to sort of a taking. And then the second point I want to make is based upon a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is really nice. It's in the books of Bukhari and Muslim, and it comes from Anas, who said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, there are three things which, if these three things are present in a person, that person will attain the sweetness of faith, halawat al-iman, that God and his Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam should be ahab, more beloved to that person, right, than anything and everything else, than all else, and that person should love others for the sake of God alone, and that person should hate to return to kufr, or disbelief, after Allah had rescued him from it, much as that person would hate to be cast into a blazing fire. So basically, this hadith talks about sort of the three ingredients for iman, and not just sort of a very sort of, I guess one could say, a default or base level or baseline level of iman, but a more highly evolved level of faith, where truly that person's iman is dearer to them than everything else, where they're not willing to compromise their faith, for example, based upon a bad relationship, right? And we see that happening often in our community. A marriage sours, for example, especially in the case of women, and they've left the faith. Or, you know, for example, a partnership goes awry, people are working together, and because of that, they become disillusioned with Allah Ta'ala. You know, so this idea of our iman being sweet to us, and what this means is that, in essence, this person actually sort of finds some type of, I think some of the commentaries mentioned, they actually find a pleasure in being a person of faith, and the analogy they make is to sort of the sweetness that one senses on his or her tongue when they taste honey, that literally their faith becomes sweet and dear to them. You know, something that's really beautiful about this hadith, and sometimes it's hard to get it until Allah kind of places people in your lives that are maybe challenging to love, is this idea of loving someone for the sake of Allah. And when I first heard this hadith some years ago, I said, well, it doesn't really sound very romantic. What does it mean that you love someone for the sake of Allah only? Does it mean that you don't care for that person for their intrinsic traits? What does this mean exactly, love for the sake of Allah? And then, you know, some years later, I mean, I honestly just through sort of the experience of getting married and, you know, we're coming up on our 10th anniversary, inshallah, and having children, you know, you realize that sometimes it's really easy to love someone and sometimes it can be really challenging. And this hadith is probably about when it's more challenging, right? Because when someone is nice to you, when someone is good to you, when someone basically does nice stuff for you, you're going to like that person. But conversely, when someone is difficult to get along with, or you feel that someone is sort of, you know, say there are things that you'd like to do and your parent is sort of saying, no, you can't do those things. So you see obstacles in your path. You know, if there are personality clashes, for example, within the context of a marriage, if you're experiencing a generational divide between you and your children, I mean, in those instances, it can become really difficult to love the person, right? And then all you sort of see is that you kind of see the person's problems and the person's bad qualities, and you kind of forget about all the good stuff this person has done. It's at that time when you really kind of need to, like, you know, seek recourse through this hadith and think about the fact that this is love for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what does that mean? This basically, like, there's a saying attributed to Yahya ibn Mu'adh that this type of love for the sake of Allah ta'ala, it's not conditional. It's really, there aren't any strings attached. So if in the case of the person's sort of beneficence or generosity to you, your love doesn't grow. And in case their goodness towards you shrinks, or they become sort of dry or aloof towards you, that your love doesn't diminish. So this is love based upon this factor of transcendence, which is really Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what elevates your love. And I think it's really helpful for those of you who are thinking about getting married, you're in marriage talks, you're newlyweds, you know, you really kind of have to think about love in those terms. You know, it might not be the case, for example, if you're a woman, he might not always be able to provide the nafaqa or the maintenance or the level of living to which you're accustomed or that you would desire, right? In the case of men, you know, you might find that once you and your wife have children that, you know, all of a sudden she's exhausted and her attention towards you is not what it used to be when you first got married. You know, you're going to find things coming out about each other's personality. You're going to encounter challenges. And the thing to understand is that as long as you attach your love for that person to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that will help you to continue to love that person through the difficult times. You know, so that, you know, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, speaking about the way he reconciled the hearts of the muhajirin and the ansar, you know, this, it's a gift. Just like iman is a gift, the love that is placed in your heart for someone that's a challenging person to love, this is a gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, because look at our culture, look how much romantic love, and I hope someone's keeping time, look how much romantic love is sort of extolled, right? This idea of sort of meeting somebody and, you know, eyes meet across the room and, you know, then, you know, we're told then there's this spark, and I've had someone tell me, well, you know, if I don't feel love, you know, if my heart doesn't thump, thump, thump when I see the sister, that means we're not going to have any success. You know, that's not what it's about. I mean, that type of image of love that's being pushed is very shallow, it's very surface, and honestly, it's just sort of predicated on what's going to be a very fleeting physical attraction. once the reality, you know, of life sets in, then you're going to need something a lot more sort of sustaining and transcendent and real to sort of get you through everything. And you're going to find that those feelings of excitement that you had in the engagement process or as a newlywed, those feelings, inshallah, are going to transform to something that is sort of much more moderating. And that's the thing about these texts that's so beautiful. You know, this idea of loving Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, obeying the Prophet to sallallahu alaihi wasallam to attain Allah's love, this idea of loving someone for the sake of Allah and cherishing your faith, the whole idea is to sort of develop a human being who's following that path of moderation, right? They're not embracing excesses in their emotional attachment, because the danger of sort of embracing this excess is that if the person does you wrong, then you're not going to want to do anything good for them in return, right? That intense love that we see in our culture, you know, where people are madly in love and the media follows them around, and then a few months later or a couple years later, they can't stand each other. And sadly, that even happens in the Muslim community. I mean, that people think that they're in love, and before they know it, that love is sort of transformed or is morphs into this incredible, intense hatred. And as Muslims, we definitely need to avoid those sort of extremes. And it doesn't mean that you don't love, you know, your husband or wife or children, you know, with all your heart. I mean, you know, human beings we're social people, and we are created to form attachments and bonds. But it means that those feelings are moderated, so that when that love might wane, or like I said, when that person is difficult to love, then you're brought to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you can moderate your response, and you don't violate that person's right. And who can remind me of that hadith? You know, there's a really beautiful hadith of the Prophet, where he talks, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, where he talks about why you should marry your daughter to someone who has, I think it's why you should marry your daughter to someone who has piety. Why is that? Why the emphasis on piety? Real piety. I think, you know, it's the hadith that, you know, basically, because if he loves, you know, your daughter, then he'll do right by her, right? But because he has piety, if for some reason there is no love in that marriage, at least he won't oppress her and take away her rights. So again, that idea that love, it's transcendent, it's attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's imbued with the sense of responsibility towards the other person. So those really are, you know, the points that I want to make. I'm not sure how we're doing for time. 5 minutes? Okay, so there are a couple things, inshallah, that I'll add to that in terms of love. And this actually comes from sort of a presentation where I looked at the prophetic view of marriage. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as we know, said that when a person marries, they have fulfilled half of their religion, so let them fear Allah regarding the remaining half. And there's a lot of sort of commentary and discussion on what does it mean to have fulfilled half of your deen by entering into this relationship. What it means essentially is that if you go into this marriage, right, and half of your religion is taqwa, then the other half is what? The other half is building and sustaining relationships that are moderated by this taqwa. And this kind of gets me back to my point about love for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're going into this marriage, hopefully, with the idea that you're going to create an attachment with this person that you're marrying and with their family members. Inshallah, you know, you might be blessed with children. And, you know, with each one of those relationships, there is an attendant set of responsibilities. And there's no way that you're going to be motivated in the context of that marriage to carry out your responsibility unless you have an equal measure, i.e. the other half is taqwa. Because that is what keeps you going, right? That at the end of the day, you're accountable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for, did you give that person their rights, or did you take that person's rights away from them? So those are some important points to remember. And then the definition of marriage, I think this is important to think about as we discuss love and loving for the sake of Allah. You know, if we want, I think the ultimate example of sort of romantic love is really the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I mean, that's why his sunnah is so unique, because we see in his relationship with each one of his wives, the mothers of the faithful, may Allah be pleased with them, is that he had a certain level of love, and like for each wife, when he was with that wife, she felt as if she was the most beloved to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And with each wife, a different aspect of the Prophet's personality was brought out. But sort of overall, you see in the model of prophetic marriage this idea of the Quranic description of love, which I think is the most beautiful, that they are your garments and you are their garments. I mean, that's how love functions. Love functions so that you basically act as a support for that person, you're protecting that person, you're bringing out the best in that person. And the only way you can do that is with, again, a healthy measure of taqwa, a lot of patience, and a lot of love. And as we saw in the Prophet's marriage, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was infinitely patient with his wives, and even when they kind of pushed him to the very limit, and you think this is a situation where it's difficult to show love, still the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam showed love and forbearance. So I think there is a lesson, even for those who sort of are really kind of, you know, for them it's just romantic love and that's all they're kind of, that's all that's on their radar. Look at the example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and how he went through those different stages of relationships with his wives. He had wives who were older and wives who were younger, and, you know, each one of those mothers of the faithful brought out different aspects of love from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but all of it was joined by the fact that his heart was attached to the divine and their hearts were attached to the divine. So jazakumullah khair for your time and attention. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.